Source.
All right, thank you. 25, make it 24 minutes before 10 o'clock. And have you ever like found yourself like blaming everybody else for your problems and then you realize, wait a minute, maybe it's me, right? John Kim is on the phone. John is known as the angry therapist. He's actually done a lot of great work for people and couples. He's a pioneer of the online life coaching movement. He's the founder of the life coach company called JRNI, which is creating a new way to help people help people and change the way that we change. And his book has got a title that I can't read completely. It's called I Used to Be a Miserable F-CK or F*CK. You get the picture, right? It's an everyman's guide to a meaningful life, but it's his memoir, and he's being I love this about the book. He's being honest with us. And if you're honest with yourself, you realize that a lot of the things you've been blaming other people for really kind of fall back on yourself. It's a hard pill to swallow sometimes. Good morning, John. It's an honor to have you on our show.
Good morning. Thank you for having me.
You're welcome. Where are you right now?
I'm in my living room. I just got back from my book tour. It's funny you mentioned the F word because on a bookstore over the PA system, they had to say, I used to be a miserable fudge. And it sounded like a children's book, like a little character of fudge that used to be miserable. It's hilarious.
Oh, that's kind of funny, yeah. So I mean, tell me about what you went through and how did this interfere or did it not interfere with the work you were doing for other people?
Yeah, so about 10 years ago, I went through a divorce and had to start all over, left with nothing. Basically, just a pillow. I got the Tempur-Pedic pillow. She got the bed. And I went through my man journey, you know, started to look inward and connect back to myself. And so that was kind of the birth of this book. At the same time, I was also trained to become a therapist, and the universe threw me to nonprofit. And after about 5 years of helping teenagers with addictions, I learned quickly that the common thread was the absent father. So dad was either not home physically or emotionally. And then I saw the product of that, and I was like, wow, this is something that we need to start talking about.
Wow. Well, that's very insightful of you. And, you know, I'm guessing there are some people who never come to that realization, and they live 80 years, and then they die, never, ever, ever realizing that. So it's really to your credit that you were able to not only see that, but that you're sharing it with the rest of us, because then we can see ourselves through your words.
Yeah, and I don't, it's weird because I don't, this sounds kind of odd, but I don't even remember writing this book. It just came from passion and my observations, and I just feel like because of that, it's bigger than me, you know, I'm just a one domino in this process.
You know, I'm wondering if the writing process maybe wasn't therapeutic for you. Maybe in writing it, you actually were able to focus more on the real problem.
Yeah, 100%. I created a blog at the lowest point of my life called The Angry Therapist. And since then, writing has been my therapy, you know, pulling the curtain back, showing myself, expressing my feelings.
Yeah.
I like the subtitle, An Everyman's Guide to a Meaningful Life, because sometimes the men seem to get the worst end of the deal, and I am such a huge advocate for rights for men, because women sometimes can do really not so nice things.
Sure, and that's also something that I think, especially today with the landscape, people aren't talking about, and so there's a lot of great men doing a lot of things who are kind of hiding and not getting credit, I guess you'd say.
You know, one of the things I wondered about, based on some of what I read from your book, I have not read a whole book, by the way. And P.S., you're getting really good reviews on Amazon. I just wanted to make sure the listeners knew that. And I think you were number one. Let me see if you were high on the list. I know that. Number seven. Look at this.
Yeah.
Number seven. It's doing pretty good. But one of the things I wondered about, did you come to this realization that, you know, as boys, we're kind of coddled. And then when we become men and we have wives, we expect them to coddle us. And wives are not mothers. And wives are not, you know, anti-adult figures, right?
Yeah, that was actually me. I call it the from mouth to nipple syndrome, where the dynamic of the relationship, instead of, you know, partners, it becomes mother-son.
Yeah, and of course that would get you angry because she doesn't want to do that, right?
Exactly.
And she never expected, and she never thought she was going to have to do that to an adult man, right?
Right, right. You know, but the good news is you could change that dynamic, you know?
Give us a technique. How do you do that?
Well, I think everything starts with looking inward, and I've got 66 do's and don'ts in a shot glass, but any of those are doors that can lead you on a path of growth and a path of revelations and who you want to be and things that you need to change, you know, behavioral stuff. And I think it's a practice. You know, it's not something that you do over the weekend. It's a way of living. It's, you have to thread it into your life to slowly change the dynamic.
Yeah, you talk about vulnerability in your book, and that's very, very important. Yeah. Sometimes people think men shouldn't have feelings, and I totally disagree with that.
Yeah, it's something that I think society, locker rooms, you know, we're kind of stamped with if you're a man, you need to fix things or build things. And we're also human, and if we don't show ourselves, express ourselves, we're suppressing all that, and we become very angry and reactive. So I think vulnerability is one of the biggest things that men should start practicing.
You know, in the song by Jimmy Buffett, Margaritaville, he has a recurring line in the chorus that says, some people say that there's a woman to blame, but I know it could be my fault. And then it goes on to, it's my own damn fault. the deeper into the song, the more sure he is that it was his fault. And that's kind of what I think we all have to recognize. And once you do, it kind of frees. It's really a gift to yourself to realize that, isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah, you're talking about taking ownership, you know, and I think men take ownership, boys don't. You're also talking about running towards yourself instead of away. So boys run away, men run toward themselves by taking ownership.
And you also are a humorist. You say, don't pee in the shower.
Yeah, I get a lot of questions about that. I mean, it's not about peeing in the shower. I used to pee in the shower all the time. I wasn't aware that women had a heightened sense of smell. If your partner's okay with you peeing in the shower, you peeing in the shower, you can write your name on the wall, it doesn't matter. But if your partner is not, and you're lying about it, you know, trying to chase it down with shampoo, they're going to think you're also lying about other things. So it's not about peeing in the shower, it's about the little hairline cracks of trust by all the white lies that we tell. So, you know, I think men don't lie, and I think boys lie all the time.
And you also talk about being adventurous, that you shouldn't just stay in your comfort zone. You should expand yourself as a person.
Yeah, I think it's on the edges, you know, being adventurous, seeking nectar, doing things that are uncomfortable. That's where our stretch is. Boys live in comfort zones, and I think men are constantly trying to push past them.
Was there a point in your life when you realized that by facing these things, you were becoming less miserable?
I think it's a gradual process, yes. And I don't want to say happy. That's why this is called I Used to Be Miserable, because I think happy today can be a bumper sticker. And, you know, with the commercialization of wellness, everyone's throwing that word around, and it's kind of loaded, you know. And there's a lot of people who are not happy, and it's okay. It's not okay to stay there, but it's okay to announce that you were miserable or that you are now.
Chapter 52, and for those who are offended by the D word, I will say it, I guess. Don't drive like a dick is what you call it. Okay. Mm-hmm. Now,
yes.
So I have a quick story to share with you. I hate when people drive like a dick. Okay.
Yeah. I live in Los Angeles, so it's
now, I don't think I ever do, but maybe I do sometimes. But anyway, so there was a guy flashing his lights at me to move over, and I was so mad at him because who are you to tell me to move over, you know? Mm-hmm. And so I literally I pulled over like he wanted me to, and then I got behind him, right? And then I was doing the same thing to him. Now, then he pulls over, I pull over next to him. We're in the parking lot, right? And he's yelling at me, and I'm yelling at him. And guess who's sitting next to me? My partner, Robin, right? And all of a sudden, it occurs to me, what if this stupid male behavior that I'm engaging in resulted in him pulling out a gun? I'm putting Robin's life at
risk.
So exactly. Right at that moment, I said, you know what? I don't care how mad people get at me. I'm not even going to look at them anymore. If I look at them, I'm going to get mad. So I won't even look at them. I'll turn up the radio and listen to whatever. But you're right.
That story, that's exactly kind of what happened to me. And that's when I realized that you're putting other people, you're taking someone hostage when you do that.
Yeah.
Passenger.
I love the conversation. Good luck with the book. It's already getting good reviews. I have a copy of it here. Call me if you'd like the copy that was sent to us. I found it on Amazon. Do you want to direct us to a different website?
No, that's all. It's Amazon, Barnes & Noble, my site, theangrytherapist.com, and then social media, at theangrytherapist, on all social media platforms.
Okay, theangrytherapist.com is your website. Thank you, John. Yeah. Kim, thank you so much for being on the show with us today, and congratulations on figuring this out and sharing it with the rest of us.
Thank you so much for helping me create a dialogue.
You're welcome. We'll be right back.
Okay.
This Saturday, February 16th, come out to the Circle Square Cultural Center from 9 a.m. till 1 p.m. as On Top of the World Communities presents the annual